This is the most basic chemical compound in the world. Without it, man could not exist. Chemically, it is H2O. Actually, it makes life possible. In our 20th century industrialized, urbanized society, the procurement of water and the disposal of it and its allied wastes looms high on the list of our community problems. We get our water from the river, and when we are finished with it, we put it back. In the middle of that seemingly simple cycle is a unique struggle to purify the water so that it can be used. This Expedition St. Louis will examine our water. Not the sparkling water that flows from every faucet, but the clouded waters, the dirty, fetid waters that man has polluted in the conquest of his environment. This is water, partially purified midway through the complicated process that undergoes between river and faucet. This water could have been drawn from the Meramec, Missouri, or Mississippi. Nearly all the water used in the St. Louis area comes from one of those three sources. How many of us have ever taken a close look at the raw product, this water that we drink? This is it. Water filled with mud, silt, refuse, scum. And what are the things we cannot see? The bacteria, invisible destroyers that carry dysentery, encephalitis, typhoid, cholera, and a host of other killers. They are there, and they can kill if the conditions are right. Why are our rivers like this? Well, because others have done unto us what we in turn do to still others. Civic officials in this area are concerned, so is the federal government. Armed with a new law, the Federal Water Pollution Control Act, the government can force cities to correct pollution problems. The St. Louis area municipalities are no exception. 4 years ago, action was begun to clean up our rivers. To find out about the federal powers, we asked Murray Stein, who is handling the St. Louis area case, for the Department of Health, Education, and Welfare.
What kind of control over municipalities and industries does the federal government have in the area of water pollution?
The federal government is authorized to abate pollution of interstate waters affecting the health or welfare of persons in the state other than that in which the discharge originates. The enforcement proceedings are divided into three stages: conference, and a the pollution is not cleared up after a conference between the state agencies concerned and the federal government, a public hearing is called by the Secretary of Health, Education, and Welfare. If pollution is then not abated, the Secretary refers the case to the Attorney General of the United States for appropriate court action.
The pressure is on. Communities throughout the country are working to abate pollution, whether they want to or not. In the meantime, the problem of making today's water drinkable still exists. Chemists constantly work to convert the waters of the rivers so that we may drink it. John Tepker, superintendent of purification for the St. Louis County Water Company, said this.
It is not the mud in the rivers that presents the challenge to the waterworks chemists today. It is the means of devising ways of removing the invisible taste and odor producing substances, and also in killing the harmful or disease producing bacteria which are present in our rivers in ever increasing quantities.
This is our drinking water before it is tapped off the flow of the river, dark with soil, contaminated, undrinkable. Throughout the St. Louis area, water is literally pulled from the rivers through large intake pipes powered by monster pumps that siphon off millions of gallons daily. Each of these giants can process up to 20 million gallons in 24 hours. Now the raw river water begins its complicated journey to the consumer. The first step is a preliminary sedimentation basins where the mud and other suspended matter are allowed to settle to the bottom. To hurry the process along, lime is added to sink the largest solids. This is the first of many chemical treatments the water will undergo. Huge scrapers constantly traverse the bottom of the beds, removing only the solids that are heavy enough to settle. The scrapers deposit the settled material into drain pipes. From these pipes, the sludge residue is forced out under tremendous pressure to drying beds. The water in the preliminary settling basins is next pumped into the mixing and coagulation basins. Here, iron sulfate, another coagulant, is added. The small particles precipitate together. When the collected scum is heavy enough, it sinks. This process is repeated several times, each treatment making the water clearer than before. After sufficient mixing and coagulation, the water is passed on to the secondary mixing chambers, passing over a flume, which aerates the flow, removing foreign tastes or odors. At the same time, chlorine is added to kill the remaining bacteria. In the secondary beds, the slowly moving wooden paddles continue their endless rotation. By now, the water is relatively clear. Ultimately, the partially treated water, coagulated, settled, scraped, paddled, and chlorinated, is ready for the final stages of purification. For the first time, the water will be treated under a roof in these filtering beds. The water purification process throughout is notable for the absence of the human element. Here is one manufacturing procedure that is almost completely automated. This giant panel controls nearly the entire operation, including the flow into the filtering beds. The water will be filtered through 27 inches of sand and gravel. The filtration beds must be cleaned periodically. To clean the sand, water is forced up through from below. This reverse flow is then pumped out through sewer lines, and the filtered beds are again ready to receive the partially treated water from the storage basin. The water, soon to be consumed by the people throughout the St. Louis area, is given its last cleaning. What comes out of the water purification plants is something far different from the original liquid that was pumped out of the nearby river. This is water fit to drink. Now it goes into the mains to meet the needs of homes and industry. Each of us uses more than 200 gallons of water each day. Combined with industrial water consumption, the per capita share of water is a staggering 1,300 gallons each and every day of the year. The wastes and residue of the urban areas must be disposed of in some way, otherwise life would not be tolerable. To carry these away, sewers are necessary. In more primitive days, these were not needed, but the inroads of modern life are compelling in their demands. With an ever-growing population and more industrial expansion, sewers, like the companion waterways, are an indelible partner in modern life. As the acres of new housing creep out into what was once farmland, the twin tentacles of water main and sewer pipe follow along. Once completed, the sewers will guide the flow of waste to treatment plants in areas that have them, or will deposit the outflow into natural streams as raw sewage, which is another deposit into the already clouded waters. So that the wastes can flow in defiance of gravity when necessary, scattered throughout this area, strategically placed lift stations give an uphill flow that necessary boost to keep it moving. Lift stations of this type cost an average of $30,000 each. There are 42 of them in the St. Louis City and County area, served by the Metropolitan Sewer District. In this way, the molten sewage arrives at a treatment plant. 12 million gallons a day flow into the plants operated by the Metropolitan Sewer District. but that is less than 10% of the total St. Louis City and County wastes. The rest of the refuse is discharged directly into streams. Today, the treatment stations, in many cases, are operating beyond capacity. The machinery, built for a more leisurely pace, now faces a hopeless overload. If the flow is too great for a plant to handle, the excess is bypassed directly into the nearby stream, or the pace of the plant is speeded up and waste is processed through only partially treated. Following the addition of lime to precipitate the largest particles, the flow is sent to the primary tanks where scrapers remove the settled sludge. Some wastes will settle to the bottom, but grease and oil will rise to the top. The process of cleaning and purifying these wastes is closely akin to the allied water purification process. The sludge removed at this time is sent to a digester. Here, under controlled heat, the bacteria in the sludge breaks down the waste. From the primary tanks, the remaining sewage is pumped into the aeration tanks. In these, oxygen is added to the waste, along with sludge fed back from the digester. This treatment encourages bacteria to break down the unwanted solids. During this process, one of the perplexing problems of treatment appears. Non-soluble detergents, byproducts of thousands of washing machines and kitchen sinks. Modern technology created detergents, but cannot determine a way to break down that tenacious compound. So the foamy residue goes through unchanged and unchallenged. The oxygen added here revitalizes the wastes. Life of any kind, animal or vegetable, including beneficial bacteria, is impossible without it. Lack of oxygen in the liquid is one of the reasons raw sewage is a sentence of death to a stream. From the aeration tanks, the wastes are pumped into the final tanks. Here, the slowly moving paddles work to settle more solids. On paper, at least, this water is supposed to be pure and drinkable when it leaves the treatment plant, but many times it is not. Faced with the inexorable incoming volume, too often the wastes must be hurried through to keep up. The end product of the treatment plant goes into the streams of the St. Louis area. Once sylvan creeks have been harnessed to an unpicturesque task. Millions of gallons of this and worse are poured into the 200 miles of streams in St. Louis. The fluid has been precipitated, settled, aerated, paddled, digested. But it still comes out like this. Frothy with detergent, murky and slightly smelly. Another contribution to the clouded waters. This is the story of the treated wastes. But that isn't all. Many areas don't treat sewage at all. The raw filth is fed directly to the streams, or into a community or individual septic tank for a partial treatment. Septic tanks, on a scale like this, are no solution to the problem of efficient disposal of wastes, because the end product still trickles its black presence into a free-running stream. Sewage treatment in the St. Louis area runs the gamut from the elaborate to non-existent, from treatment plants to no treatment at all. This is the contribution the city of St. Louis makes to the clouded waters. This is raw sewage beginning its long trip to the Mississippi. It is a smelly, disease-ridden outflow. On film, this looks like a pleasant stream, sylvan and picturesque. In reality, it is not a natural stream at all. It is an open sewer. St. Louis is not alone in its non-treatment of sewage. Many area communities are guilty of the same crime. We asked Peter Mattei, executive director of the Metropolitan Sewer District, why the city of St. Louis has continued to dump raw sewage into the Mississippi throughout the years. Mr. Mattei, other cities have treated their wastes for years. Why hasn't St. Louis followed suit long ago?
Well, of course, other cities have treated their waste for years, but we know that a good many of them didn't by the amount of suits that have had been brought. by the federal government to force, in some instances, bond issues to be passed, etc. Well, you have to realize that we had, going past our doors, probably the largest river in velocity and in volume as there is in the world. This kind of lulled the thinking of the engineers and the residents in the area into thinking that they could never, under any circumstances, overpollute this water. Consequently, very little thought was ever given to removing pollution from the Mississippi River, and this was only natural. But with the advent of new industries and chemicals and plastics and so forth, which give off a tremendous amount of waste, these rivers soon became overpolluted.
And the federal government has said that this river must receive no more untreated wastes from the St. Louis area municipalities and industries. Under this dictate, these open sewers are to disappear. To harness and treat this malignant flow is an expensive and time-consuming process. Where necessary, federal matching funds are available to communities to assist in the financing of sewers and treatment plants. The cities raise their funds through the sale of bonds. On the west side of the river, the Metropolitan Sewer District is pushing forward with the construction of the Gravois Trunk Sewer. In the St. Louis County area, the wastes have been discharged mainly into two creeks, the Gravois and the Coldwater. Plans call for sewage to be fed instead into two giant trunk sewers. Ultimately, these will lead to two treatment plants. The plants will receive all wastes from the Metropolitan Sewer District area, including the city of St. Louis. In this way, all sewage will be treated before entering the river, complying with the federal demands for the abatement of pollution in the Mississippi. The cost of such overwhelming revamping of the sewage disposal system is shown in the construction of the Gravois Trunk Sewer. For each foot that the huge pipes inch forward, the cost is $80. By and large, St. Louis and the Metropolitan Sewer Districts are proceeding on schedule. But on the Illinois side of the river, in some places, the story is different. Very little has been done to combat pollution in East St. Louis, Granite City, Madison, Venice, Monsanto, and Cahokia. Communities that have completed construction or have it underway are Alton, Wood River, Roxana, Hartford, DuPont, Columbia, and Chester. A problem like the one the St. Louis area faces is not solved overnight, nor in a year or so. The federal timetable for completion of treatment plants, as set in 1958, was December 1961, and it's obvious that this schedule will not be met. The lag of the Illinois communities is most serious. St. Louis is behind schedule, but not so critically. In addition to the activity in the county, the city of St. Louis made a stride toward immediate pollution abatement. On September 16, 1961, the two giant incinerators operated by the city of St. Louis began to function in a slightly different way. Till then, the sanitation department had collected rubbish and garbage separately. The rubbish was brought to the incinerators, while the garbage was ground and dumped into the Mississippi. Now, however, the incinerators glow around the clock as both rubbish and garbage are dropped in the receiving pits. The refuse and garbage brought in during an 8-hour shift is enough to keep the glowing furnaces stoked for 24 hours. On the floor below, the furnace tender opens the filled box, and the refuse slides down into 1,600 degrees of heat. The ashes from these ceaseless fires will be hauled away for landfill. So, a portion of what has been polluting the Mississippi River downstream from St. Louis is transformed into ashes and smoke each day. This means that 300 tons of potential pollution never reaches the river. But the city still discharges raw sewage into the river and will continue to do so until the proposed treatment plants are constructed, a step that will cost over $100 million. As Peter Mattei has pointed out, industrial wastes are a major contributor to our pollution problem. Industries are subject to the same ultimatum that the cities face. Stop pollution. 80% of the water used by industry is for cooling, which means it is warm when returned to the rivers. It is water low in oxygen. This deficiency is a killer. Fish and bacteria need oxygen in water to live. The other hazard of industrial waste is the chemical content, which alters taste and odor. Throughout the St. Louis area, industries are cooperating. The Public Health Service has commended several local firms for their pre-treatment of wastes at the source. Among these are the International Shoe Company, Sinclair Oil, Standard Oil, and Shell Oil. Outstanding among these industry-owned treatment plants is the one owned by the Shell Refinery at Wood River, Illinois. This and the plants operated by the other refineries have made a substantial abatement in the pollution by petroleum wastes. The effluent is first neutralized so that it is neither acid nor alkaline and aerated to insert oxygen, then pumped into the ever-present primary tank, where scrapers skim the oily scum that has come to the surface. It is then pumped over a flume to provide additional aeration. The waste next goes to a settling pond where it is retained for 12 hours. Then it is pumped to a trickle filter. The water sprayed out by the revolving pipes is filtered through 10 feet of gravel and rock, 140 feet in diameter. From here, it is returned to the Mississippi. The end product bears little resemblance to the oily mass that left the refinery. We asked Murray Stein about the federal government's reaction to the changes brought about since that first conference in 1958.
At that time, it was found that sources on both sides of the river, municipal and industrial, were discharging untreated vast amounts of waste, causing gross pollution of the Mississippi River in the vicinity and below St. Louis. This interfered with a variety of water uses. Since that time, on the west side of the river, the St. Louis Metropolitan Sewer District has made considerable progress in providing treatment facilities for the Gravois Creek watershed and going ahead on schedule with planning for treatment of the entire metropolitan district under its jurisdiction. The discharge of untreated garbage to the river has been discontinued. There is only one dark spot here, and that is the Coldwater Creek watershed. Due to some litigation in the area, it has not been possible to proceed on schedule with remedial action in this area. This is interfering with the normal and logical development of treatment on the west side of the river. On the east side of the river, while several of the industries and smaller municipalities have made some progress, the situation is not quite so bright. We have had 5 meetings with representatives of Illinois and Missouri since the conference. Since that time, we have been told that the people on the east side were planning and cooperating. Interminable cooperation is no substitute for adequate waste treatment. The people in this area are living out their lives on the shores of a polluted river. This pollution must be abated. The federal government has a responsibility to see that this is done. We would hope that the communities and industries on the east side of the river would get together with their state representatives and each other and work out an equitable solution. If that is not done within the immediate future, it is inevitable that we must have an agonizing reappraisal of this situation in Washington to determine the future course of the federal government.
Murray Stein made the statement that interminable cooperation is no substitute for adequate waste treatment. The St. Louis area must take remedial action or the federal government will act. It is part of a story being played out all over this country, as man is being coerced into saving his most precious commodity, water. We will have to pay for these improvements. This is part of the price we must pay for the inadequacies of the past, the price we must pay to clear the clouded waters.